Okay, so that tells us what's happening here. Let's look at the final column. It says differences within New Jersey, see footnote B. What does footnote B say? Difference in employment between low wage, $4.25 per hour, and high wage stores, colon, and difference in employment between mid-range and high wage stores. Okay, so what they do here, this first column, low minus high, that's the first thing it said, difference in employment between low and high. So they're going to take this number here, this is the employment before in the low wage store, and subtract it from the employment in the high wage. You take these difference, you get this, minus 2.6. And then if you take this difference here, you get 0.6. So here, so that's how they're actually computing these numbers. Same thing here, you take this difference, you get this, this, you get this, this, you get this, etc. And then over here, they're taking, comparing the high wage to the mid-range. So you subtract this number from this, and you get this. Okay, and vice versa for all of these. You know, why would they do that? Well, remember, one of the main assumptions in difference-in-difference analysis is the common trends assumption. Over here, we were using Pennsylvania as our control group. We were saying that if the minimum wage law had not been passed in New Jersey, that what would have happened is the trend in employment from Pennsylvania would have been the trend in employment in New Jersey. Okay, that's how we're getting the counterfactual for what would have happened if the law hadn't been passed in New Jersey. So is that true? Is Pennsylvania that similar to New Jersey? Maybe not. So in order to check that assumption in some sense, we're going to use a slightly different control group. We're going to use a different control group. Here the idea is we use the high wage stores in New Jersey as our control group. So these high wage stores were already paying wages pretty much above what the new minimum wage was. So you might think that, you know, maybe they're just not affected by treatment at all. Okay, so they might be a good control group for the stores who were paying the minimum wage and therefore are forced to increase their wage. So yet, let's use them as the comparison group for the low wage stores instead of Pennsylvania as our comparison group. So if we do that, we get these numbers here in this lower portion of the table. We use the low wage compared to the high wage. And if we take, this is a difference in the employment for just the low wage. This here is a difference in employment for just the high wage. And this number here is a difference in differences. It's the difference of this difference and this difference. That's a lot of differences. So if we do that for each one of these combinations, we see that the numbers here are pretty much similar to the numbers we got over here, 2.96. They're all about 3 workers increase. So overall, we see that we've done a bunch of robustness checks, and that even if we use a different control group for getting that common trend, we see the same finding as over here, as our initial main finding, that the minimum wage law actually increased employment by about 3 people. So that was a lot of stuff. And the reason we had to go through all these other numbers is that we don't want to just do one analysis based on one idea of let's use Pennsylvania as our control group, because maybe that's not the true answer. Maybe one of our assumptions wasn't correct. And it's very hard to check these assumptions. So we have to do a bunch of different kinds of analysis to tweak our assumption here, tweak our assumption there, and hope that our conclusions don't change a lot if we change our assumptions. That's the idea of robustness and robustness checks. And that's what a lot of many applied papers spend most of their time doing, is they find one of these identification strategies, they implement it, and then spend all the rest of the time arguing that the assumptions necessary for using the identification strategy hold, or that if you tweak them in a little bit of a different way, use a little bit of different data, you come to the same qualitative conclusion. So the next time you pick up a research paper and you see a bunch of crazy tables like this, don't fear. Just remember, they're complicated to everyone. You're just going to have to take some time to go through it logically, figure out what their identification strategy is, how are they trying to learn about causality. Start reading the tables slowly, look at the footnotes, go back to the body, and hopefully you'll come across with a good conclusion and a good understanding of whatever that policy is you're interested in.